I've been trying to create binary storage in Super Mario Maker for almost 3 years now. No matter what I tried, nothing worked so far. But recently we found out about global ground and track memory, which suddenly opens up millions of new ways to build Mario Maker contraptions, and which finally allows us to store information in at least somewhat usable ways. In this video, we are going to take a look at different ways to store information in Super Mario Maker. We'll take a look at read and writable binary storage, at a super useless contraption that is able to shift bits, and we'll discuss what the heck binary storage actually is. Just before we start, I want to give a quick shout out to Mario Maker creator Giant. He's the creator that built the calculator that went viral, and he's built some insanely clever and awesome stages, including a freaking Rubik's Cube and shift puzzles in Mario Maker. He's been using global ground and ELB manipulation in his courses long before I figured it out, and I learned a lot of the tricks that we're going to use in this video by taking a look at his levels. I highly recommend everyone to check his user profile out. You can find the link in the description. His levels are beyond amazing. So with that being said, are you ready? Let's do this! Okay, so first, let's take a look at a simple way to count globally before we take a look at real binary storage. Here Mario finds himself in front of a super simple contraption. There is a shell that is blocked by 4 bullet blasters, and there is a POW block. If Mario triggers all 4 skeleton roller coasters at the bottom, then the POW block becomes triggered. Nothing too fancy so far. The cool thing about this contraption is that it works globally, as soon as it was loaded in once. All items here stand on top of blue platforms on tracks, and are therefore stored in the track memory and never despawn. So if Mario goes to the far right here and triggers the 4 skeleton roller coasters, the POW block should activate as soon as the platforms reach their destination. Hooray! This allows us to store the information globally how many skeleton roller coasters were activated and to trigger a POW block once this number reaches 4. That's something that could be really useful for a couple of stages, but that's no real binary storage, since the information stored in the cell cannot be accessed nor really manipulated. This functions more like a relational operator that tests if the amount of skeleton roller coasters triggered is equal 4, and if true, triggers a POW block. That's useful, but not fancy enough. Only real binary storage is fancy enough. Okay, so what is binary storage? Well, it's actually surprisingly simple. So storage is storage, and a binary number is a different representation of numbers. So the number system we use in everyday life works on a base of 10. We have 10 different numbers, 0 to 9, which represent 10 different values. If we count higher than 10, then we simply add a new number, base 10, in front of our previous number. So the number 13 can also be read as 10 plus 3, and the number 9352 can also be read as 9000 plus 300 plus 50 plus 2, or like this. I know, that sounds super ultra boring, but stay with me for a moment, because it's honestly truly fascinating, and understanding this can really help in Super Mario Maker and math. The thing is, while our number system based on 10 makes a lot of sense for everyday use, a computer can't understand it on its most basic level. On its most basic level, a computer is only able to understand if there is electricity,
thunder,
or not. There are only these two states, either there is electricity, and this is represented by a 1, or there isn't, which is often represented by a 0. But a modern computer is able to store this information millions and millions of times. So the thing is, the information 1 or 0 can be represented in a different numerical system than ours, the binary system. That's a numerical system that uses a base of 2 instead of a base of 10. So instead of the numbers 0 to 9, we only use the two numbers 0 and 1 to represent information. And instead of adding a new number every time we count up to a new power of 10, we add a new number every time we reach a power of 2. So our number 1 is the same in binary and in our common numerical system. But as soon as we count to 2, the representation changes. Our numerical system has a number for 2, but the binary system hasn't. So we write a new 1 in front of the old number, meaning we represent a power of 2. Anyone's head ouching? Let's take a quick look at a small Mario Maker trick and come back here later. Usually, when an item enters a vertical track piece, the item always cycles downwards. It doesn't matter how the track is shaped, it will always cycle downwards. but sometimes we want items to travel upwards instead. Luckily, there is a neat little trick, because this platform actually decides to cycle upwards. The reason why this platform is different is because this platform hit the very bottom of the track piece. Whenever an item on tracks lands on the very bottom of a track piece, it will cycle upwards. We can even manipulate the layout of a track so that we can always control how items behave. Useful, isn't it? We'll use this trick a lot in a moment. Okay, back to number theory. So in binary, every number represents a power of 2 instead of a power of 10. The number 13 looks like this in binary, which means 8 plus 4 plus 0 plus 1, or this. And this is what 9352 looks like. It's actually super easy to calculate with such numbers, but I'll spare you for the moment. So computers store information like numbers in this way, and finding a way to represent information in such a way in Super Mario Maker is the basis to create actual computers. One such number is called a bit, and 8 such numbers in a row are referred to as bytes. Okay, so what we need to build in Mario Maker is a storage cell where we can write different bits and then are able to read the stored information so that we are able to use it. So here's the first thing I tried. Don't be afraid of all the tracks, it's super simple. The idea here is to change the position of the bullet blaster when a blue platform is triggered. A blaster to the left represents a 1 and a blaster to the right represents a 0. There are two input tracks. If a platform on the right input track is triggered, the blaster is set to 1. And if a platform on the left is triggered, the blaster is resetted to 0. Because of this, we're able to flip-flop the bullet blaster from set to reset. Awesome, isn't it? Let's call this a set reset flip-flop. The blasters stand on top of fire bars so that they're on global ground and don't despawn. Okay, so currently both blasters are set to 0, but to our plumber's right is actually a small contraption that allows us to set the bits remotely. If Mario wants to change the bits, he simply needs to activate the corresponding platform. So here, he set 1 bit to 1 and 1 to 0, and if we run back, hooray! 1 bit is set and 1 isn't. Cool, isn't it? But there is a problem. Currently, we are able to write information into our storage, but there's no way to retrieve the information stored again. That's about as useful as Wikipedia without access to it. There's actually a way to build readable storage as well. Here we use a slightly optimized version of the set reset flip-flop from before. It works the same way as before, but this time the two positions are closer together. You'll see why in a second. Other than that, it's the same. We can set bits to 1 by using one input line and set them to 0 by using the other one. Super simple. We have 4 such storage cells wired together, so we are able to store up to 16 different values in this array. But the cool thing is that we're not only able to store this information here, we are also able to read it again. So let's say Mario wants to store the number 6. In order to do so, he needs to set the two bullet bits in the middle of the storage array. Cool, 6 is set. Up here, we have an output platform. If Mario activates this platform, then the value stored in the storage cell gets read and is displayed in binary afterwards. There is only a small problem. It takes half a minute to read a super simple number. Sorry about that, but as it turns out, Super Mario Maker isn't the fastest hardware for calculation. But eventually, hooray, our number appears. We're now able to further work with this number. But let's first check out how the reading works. It's actually ridiculously simple. There are POW blocks, which live on top of the bullet blasters. The reading platform simply picks them up and transfers them to the output. If a blaster is not set, then the POW block gets lifted but drops back down again, because there is an evil ice block blocking him. If a bullet bit is set, however, then there is no evil ice block blocking the platform, which allows it to kidnap the poor POW block. The platform is set up in such a way that each POW is picked up at the corresponding bit spot. Okay, so what are we able to do with this binary information? Well, not much currently, but at least a little bit. First, it's incredibly easy to build a bit mask, which can be used to test for specific bits. If you want to test where the least significant bit is set, that's the one to the far right, then all we need to do is to block this specific bit, and if it is set, then the POW block drops down. Whenever the least significant bit is set, then the number stored is uneven, and whenever it is not set, then the number is an even number. So for example, we can have a door that only opens up if Mario stores an uneven number into the storage. Awesome. Where things become really interesting is if we find a way to perform logical bit operations onto our information. Okay, So bit operations. There are, if we simplify things a little bit, four main ways to manipulate sets of binary information. There is the NOT operator, which complements every information stored. So every 1 becomes a 0 and every 0 a 1. There is the AND operation that takes two binary numbers and outputs which bits are set in both numbers. So for example, if we take the number 1011 and the number 0111, then we get the number 0011, because only the last two bits are set in both numbers. Then there is the OR operation that returns true if either one of the two bits is set or both. So if we take 1001 and 1100, for example, we get the number 1101, since only the second bit isn't set in any of the inputs. And then there are bit shifts. A bit shift basically shifts all bits stored in a number towards the right or towards the left. Since the binary numerical system works at a base of 2, this means that shifting a number to the left always multiplies it by 2, and shifting a number to the right always divides it by 2. The same way that shifting a number to the right or to the left in our numerical system multiplies or divides a number by 10, since our numerical system works at a base of 10. Okay, so why do I tell you about these four operators? Well, because if we found a way to recreate all these operations in Super Mario Maker, then we would actually have kind of an assembly language for Super Mario Maker, which would be one of humanity's stranger achievements, but super awesome. So I spent more time than I'm willing to admit trying to find a way to perform those four operations onto POW blocks on top of blue platforms, and sadly, I was only able to recreate a single one of those operations. We'll take a look at this in a moment, but if any one of you wonderful ladies and gentlemen wants to toy around with this and finds a way to perform these operations on data stored on top of a blue platform, please let me know about it. That would be super awesome. But first, let's take a look at another use case of information stored in such a way. Here we have a simple password system. To Mario's right and left are 4 question blocks, and there are 2 locked doors. If Mario wants to unlock these doors, he needs to enter 2 binary numbers into each set of 4 question blocks. The key is only rewarded if the sum of both numbers entered is exactly 15. So here Mario, for example, entered 11 and 4. 11 plus 4 is 15. Once our plumber entered the 2 numbers, he's able to activate the 2 platforms close to the numbers, which loads both numbers into the sum checking system at the top. Afterwards, our plumber is finally allowed to activate the last blue platform. This one starts the super complicated sum calculation. The sum calculation is actually so complicated that calculating this only once takes about half a minute. But after these 30 seconds, Mario is rewarded with the exit key, since he entered a sum of 15 into the contraption. Hooray! If Mario entered a wrong sum, then nothing would have happened. The reason why this works is surprisingly simple. So first, we load both numbers onto platforms at the top. This is just so that we have them up there for the calculation. Then we test whether input 1 XOR input 2 outputs a combination where every bit is true, and if this is the case, we reward Mario with a key. Which is a very complicated way of saying we're building a bridge for this Goomba. Only if the sum of both numbers is 15, there is no gap in the path, nor is there a P-switch which blocks our math calculating Goomba. Awesome, isn't it? Okay, so finally, let's take a look at the one bit operation I managed to recreate in Mario Maker. Bit shifts. Here Mario first needs to run to the right so that everything gets loaded once. Then our plumber is able to input a binary number by activating skeleton roller coasters at the bottom. Each roller coaster represents one bit, where the one to the far right represents the least significant one. Our plumber decided to input the number 14. And then there is this platform. This platform is a marvelous masterpiece of Goomba engineering, because this platform divides every number entered by 2. But not only is this platform able to perform second class math tasks, it also does so within only 17 seconds. Wow, what a machine. So after 17 seconds, the platform comes back, and now the number 7 is displayed. But how was this incredibly potent platform able to perform such a complicated task within such an absurdly short amount of time? Well, the answer is because it right-shifted the input once. All bits were shifted to the right once, which equals a division by 2. But the best part has yet to come, because this platform is not only able to perform this action once, but as many times as desired. If Mario wants to shift the 7 again, all that he needs to do is to run to the right so that the platform reloads, and then he's able to activate it again. So this time, we have a problem. If we divide 7 by 2, the result is 3.5, but our binary numbers aren't able to represent numbers with one decimal place. Because of this, it drops the rest of the division into this spot, which represents 0.5, and then it outputs 3, which is once again the right result. If we divide the number once again, it outputs 1 and shows us once again that there was a rest. Awesome, isn't it? So how does all of this work? Well, it's once again super simple. First, we load in the 4 P-switches. P-switches, which spawned out of a question block or a node block, never despawn and stay loaded forever. That's incredibly useful for like billion different things, and we'll use this a lot in the future. Shout out again to Giant, that's one of the tricks I learned when checking out his awesome stages. Then we use the skeleton roller coasters to get our P-switches set and into position. The roller coaster just picks them up and drops them at the right spot, and then the surprisingly simple shifting magic happens. We drop everything that is on top of the platform. The least significant bit gets picked up by a conveyor belt if it is set, and then we pick up all the P-switches once again. But first, the platform moves one block to the left. The platform then cycles back and drops everything where it picked it up. But now it's shifted to the right by 1. Okay, so that's all about binary storage I was able to recreate. If someone of you wonderful ladies and gentlemen find some new tricks using these tricks, please let me know about it. I hope you enjoyed this little video. If you enjoyed it, don't forget to leave me a thumbs up. And maybe you feel especially confused today and want to hit the subscribe button as well. I hope that you have a wonderful day and to see you soon. Goodbye!